evening, everyone. Let's all stand and turn to page number 516. Whosoever meaneth me, 516.
I am happy today and the sun shines bright. The clouds have been all brought away. For the Savior said, whosoever will may come to him to stay. Whosoever surely meaneth me, surely meaneth me, oh, surely meaneth me. Whosoever surely meaneth me, whosoever meaneth me. All my hopes have been raised, oh, his name be praised, his glory fill my soul. I have been lifted up and from sin set free. His blood hath made me whole. Whosoever surely meaneth me, surely meaneth me, oh, surely meaneth me. Whosoever surely meaneth me, whosoever meaneth me. Oh, what wonderful love, oh, what grace divine, that Jesus has died for me. I was lost in sin, for the world I pined, but now I am set free. Whosoever surely meaneth me, surely meaneth me, oh, surely meaneth me.
Tonight.
Dear Lord, thank you for letting us be able to meet here tonight and giving us the freedom to be able to meet here over the Lord. I pray that you would let us all get something out of the sermon tonight. I pray that you would bless the singing. Dear Lord, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
stand and turn to page 538. Page number 538. Jesus is all the world to me. Page 538.
Jesus is all the world to me. My life, my joy, my heart. He is my strength from day to day. Without him I would fall. When I am sad, to him I go. No other one can cheer me so.
When I am sad, he makes me glad.
Lord, you kept me and you never left me. You stood by my side. There were so many times when I came so close. Old man Dale, he tried to take me in. So the reason I'm here is not hard for me to see. In fact, it's so easy for me to explain. It was God's grace.
God's grace.
It was God's grace.
God's grace.
It was God's grace.
God's grace.
It's amazing grace.
God's grace.
I made it this far.
Made it this far.
By the grace of God. I remember the time when I strayed away. Even though I knew the words, still I wouldn't obey. But God's mercy and His grace stayed with me and brought me, and brought me all the way. It was God's grace.
God's grace.
It was God's grace.
God's grace.
It was God's grace.
God's grace.
It was God's grace. I made it this far.
Made it this far.
By the grace of God. It was God's grace.
God's grace.
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 I made it this far.
Made it this far.
By the grace of God. It was God's grace.
God's grace.
It was God's grace.
God's grace.
It was God's grace.
God's grace.
It was amazing grace.
God's grace.
I made it this far.
Made it this far.
By the grace of God.
One more time, first and last verse of page number 421. There's an unseen hand. There is an unseen hand to me that leads to ways I cannot see.
We're still
Church for the Holy Spirit to move in my spirit, move in my heart.
Yes.
And Saturday morning I was listening to that CD going down the road while I was going to pick up the barbecue. And all of a sudden the Holy Spirit just moved in, and it just moved in my truck. And it's so sweet. That's the unseen hand that we can't see. And that's the Holy Spirit of God that moves in, that just comforts us when we need it. Just sing that chorus one more time.
I'm holding to the unseen hand that guides me through this weary land, and some sweet day I'll reach that.
Wasn't for God's grace. Brother Kevin, where would you be without God's grace?
In the ground.
It's not what I expect you to say, but I guess you're probably right. Wow. The unseen hand. I think those two songs are meant to go together. God's grace and the unseen hand. Wow. Somebody tell me. Give me a testimony about God's grace in your life. Just somebody. I know you got to think about it for a minute. I'll give you a second. Go ahead, Miss Patty.
Andrew and I have been reading this book called Ruchko, and just watching him give in to God at some of the strange requests God has given him, and then seeing how God used it, and then relating it to my own life. And when I work with my family, God sometimes will give me, I don't want to say, he doesn't speak to me, but in that still small voice, do this, say this, go here, pray with this person. Sometimes it seems strange, and especially working in the world, you're trying to shine for Jesus, and you're trying to be a light, and he tells you some of the weirdest things to do, and you do it, and then you see later on how he used that in their life or in your life. Mm-hmm. And so just that unseen hand and giving into him. It's hard, but it's so fulfilling when you do.
And freeing, too, yeah. It's good. Drew?
God's grace led us to this church.
That's true.
Amen.
That's very true.
Amen.
Only by God's grace. His unseen hand, we had no idea what God was doing. That's true. Somebody else, God's grace is working. Brother Kevin?
Some odd years. sober. And once I got straight sober, 3 years later, three and a half years later, I found out I got a brain tumor. So the devil, you know, he worked his way in there, but it was like when I got done having surgery that day, it was like I'd never had it. And the best I felt in 20-something years right now. It's amazing. It wouldn't be like that, except for God's grace.
Amen. Yeah. Somebody else, keep it going as long as you want to.
In my 20s, I went in the wrong direction. And God's grace pursued me. And because he would not leave me alone, brought me back to him, my life is completely different to what it could have been. And I'm so thankful that as a child of God, he pursued me and would not let me go. His grace is amazing. And I'm so grateful that I have a beautiful life. Because he would not give up on me.
Amen. Amen. Somebody else. Go ahead, Miss Faith.
About 44 years ago, we decided we needed a change in our life. And we went to the Lord and we prayed. And our family up at Liberty Baptist Church, they prayed with us. And we decided we were going to move to Georgia. And we had nobody down here, didn't know what we were doing. It was like, what are we doing here? But it was God's grace that led us, and God's grace that has just been with us ever since. And I miss some of our friends, but I would not miss the opportunities that God has given to us in the growth he has allowed us to feel in these 44 years. And
Amen.
It's God's
grace. Amen. For Terry, thank you. Yeah.
I got saved real late in life. The first 53 years of my life, God protected and sustained and defended me. And I can think of several occasions where I could have perished without a Savior. And I would be in that place of torment even right this very second. But his grace sustained me through those things, many of them due to that incurable disease known as stupidity, of which I am chief. I know that sounds braggadocious, but...
No, it doesn't.
but until that night of the Holy Spirit's conviction and confession of sin and repentance and salvation, he just sustained me.
Amen. Is that Miss Grace's hand? Yes. I couldn't tell if that was Miss Rose or Miss Grace. I couldn't tell. Miss Grace.
It's my God's grace that I get out of bed every morning. And I think before that, some of you probably know, I had to have back surgery. I had to have three of them in a row. Friday, Saturday, and then Sunday. I've been in the hospital for about 5 days, and then I had to go to the nursing home for 30 days to learn how to walk again. But when I was in the hospital, they hit a nerve, and the pain was indescribable. It hurt so bad. I remember saying, Lord, I can't take anymore. I don't know how I'm going to make it. I just can't take anymore. And I was just crying, and all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit said, Grace, this is nothing. You're suffering nothing compared to what I suffered for you. And I was still crying, but this time, I was
Amen. Mm.
He loved me so much. He brought me through all that. He brought me through the several other things, too. I thank
him for his love. Amen. Go ahead, Brother Albert.
In 2019, God brought me back. That song comes to me, God grace me. I couldn't get away from it. I've been sinning every day to sing it. But he healed my body. I didn't have to have no surgery. I just prayed and kept saying that song, and I got away. It was God's grace.
Amen.
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 I got
well.
I like it.
Do what?
I got well.
Yeah.
I got well too one time.
Go ahead, Miss Abby.
Many of you know that I had congestive heart failure when I was a child, and it really, I could have died. It was, in many ways, I shouldn't be alive right now. And it's through God's grace that he
And he does. He does. I'm talking about that tonight, actually. Kind of. It's good. Somebody else.
I can remember, as many of y'all know, David and I have been together since we were in diapers, practically. And I wouldn't have it any other way.
Sorry. I'm watching his face when you said it. Somebody else? Anybody? Yes, ma'am. Yes, Miss Rose.
I can vouch for that. Don't ever, ever, ever give up on your kids. Ever.
Amen. Amen. Miss Holly.
A lot of people can talk about the bad things they did in life and how God brought them out of that and saved them and protected them. I can't talk about bad things, but I can say it's the grace of God that kept me.
That's
it. The same grace that brought them and kept them is the one that kept me from getting in
Amen.
To all those things. So I'm thankful for the grace
Amen.
Of God.
Amen.
Good.
Amen.
Amen.
Can I just say I'm on the same boat with Miss Ollie on that. I'm glad I didn't have to be saved out of it. He saved me from it.
Yeah.
I'm thankful for that. Amen. Somebody else? Brother Charlie.
Yeah. I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the grace of God, because He has guided me through most of my life. I mean, when I got out of Vietnam, I got recruited by the FBI. And all of my transfers and stuff led me here. Georgia, 1975, and about four churches later, I came here to Montford Road, and I've been here since 1984.
Wow.
Yes.
I have said this before, and I don't think we can, this is to God be the glory for this, but Brother Charlie is a man of unusual faithfulness.
Amen.
Unusual faithfulness. And I mean that in a good way, not in a weird way, but unusual faithfulness. Yeah. Yes, Miss Joanne.
Grace already saved me from that.
Yes. Yes.
And I gave a track to a man over to Clement Fairgrounds. And he looked at it and he said, "Can I put this on Facebook?" I said, "Yes, you can."
Sure.
So I believe that God said to work on his turn boy.
Amen.
And passed out one yesterday to a lady. And I said, "It's all about Jesus." And it's amazing how people respond.
You're right.
On the track, they said, "Thank you." They don't know what's inside, but they're opened up. Saying, you know, where you're going to heaven or hell. You know, they throw us back off.
Right.
But he just says, "Thank you." And I have not had one person
who rejected
that.
Sure. Amen. Brother Tim. Miss Bonnie, you'll appreciate this. She didn't know. From your sister. Sandy says, this is on Facebook. Kind of weird seeing myself right here doing this, but. I thank God he saved my soul. I was backslidden for many years until my sister Bonnie invited me to come to Galilee in a little over a year ago. Since then, I've become closer to God than I've ever been in my life. I feel blessed to be able to attend church there and to have such a wonderful pastor in which I get so much out of his sermon. Turn this down. Thank you, Lord, and thank you, preacher, for everything. May God bless this church and everyone attending. And Miss Andy, we read it. Miss Bonnie, that you get a trophy for that. Not here. That came out completely wrong. You get a reward in heaven for that. Thank you, Brother Tim, for bringing your sister in like that. I remember, don't ever stop on your family. Don't ever stop. Well, we need to take up an offering. Let's go ahead and receive our offering. Don't get nervous. I know what time it is. I've got a short sermon tonight. And after these testimonies, I think it's going to go a little bit faster, just to be honest. As they're coming forward, I want to remind you about a couple of things coming up. Don't forget, I Love My Church Sunday is coming up March 19th. Looking forward to that. We'll be giving away, just like we did last year, we awarded Miss Nancy with the Sue Lutz Servant Heart Award. And we'll be doing that again this year, not to Miss Nancy, she already got it, but to another person in our church. I've been praying about it, and the thing is, when you have a long list of people, it's hard to narrow it down to one. But I think the Lord's given me peace about who to award that to this year, and we'll be doing that on that Sunday morning, March 19th, with some other things. So it'll be a great time just to love on our church family and thank the Lord for it. So be aware of that coming up very, very soon. Invite some people with you, all right? At the end of our service, we're going to have a special time of prayer. And also, just a quick, I say announcement, more like a ministry opportunity that's very simple, low commitment, just real basic, that I would like to pass off to someone or maybe a couple people in our church if the Lord would lead that way. So we'll announce that at the end of the service, though, as we look at that. All right, let's pray up our offering. Let's be faithful in our tithes and offerings this evening. And Brother Malin, why don't you lead us in prayer, if you would, sir.
Dear Lord, I thank you for our church that we can come to do and express our gratitude to you, Lord. I do pray, Father, that you bless each and every one of us here tonight. Bless our pastor, Lord, as he brings the word to us. Help us, Lord, to have open ears and open hearts to receive it, Lord. And then, Lord, I pray, Father, that you'd help us, Lord, to go out this next week and give it out to somebody else that needs it too. And, Lord, I do pray, Father, that you bless this offering. Use it for your honor and your glory. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Take your Bible this evening. We'll be in Exodus chapter 3. We're going to look one more time in this series about cures for the common cold and see one more truth. And I think this one might be a little bit out of the ordinary for you. We could talk about church attendance and prayer and Bible study and all those kinds of things. And those are good. Those are cures for the common cold. But tonight I want to show you one that you may not have thought about. That is most definitely a Sunday night topic. I'll just say that. And I want you to really listen with your heart and ask God to speak to you about this. I want to introduce it by telling you about a man who one day stepped up to a well where there was water. Took just a moment, he paused, he caught his breath, wiped the sweat from his brow, had been running for a while. He was scared, he was paranoid, full of fear. But he stopped at a well and drew some water to get a drink. Somebody of his stature would never draw water. He had probably never drawn water in his life. He had a position that allowed him to tell someone else to do it for him. He would never stoop to a menial task of fetching water for himself or for anybody else. But he stopped and he got a drink. He was a man that was a royal fugitive. He was a man on the run, literally for his life. He was without a friend anywhere in the world. And no doubt these things were running through his mind as he cupped his hand and dipped the water and put it up to his mouth and took a sip of water and looked across the desert that he was standing in. He was standing in the middle of the desert of Midian. He's about 40 years old. Been raised in Pharaoh's house since he was a baby. And this desert was the coldest desert that Moses would ever stand in. He was 40 years old, fled from Egypt, and he entered into this miserable territory of the desert. Moses was the prince of Egypt. Now at this point, though, he was the hired shepherd of his father-in-law, taking care of somebody else's sheep. And for the next 40 years, nothing, absolutely nothing would change in his life for 40 years. Initially, when Moses got there, he was living in fear of being discovered by the Egyptians because he'd run for his life after killing an Egyptian taskmaster with his own hands. After some time, though, he kind of got used to it and he felt like he was safe and he kind of got used to this kind of mediocre desert, cold lifestyle. He just accepted it as a way of life. He spent 40 years raising and leading somebody else's sheep in a cold desert. In other words, he has learned what many Christians have learned. He learned to accept mediocrity as a way of life. He had no expectations. He had no goals, no dreams, just watching sheep for his father-in-law. He probably thought, well, at least I'm not in jail, or at least I'm not caught, at least they don't know where I'm at. At least my past hasn't caught up with me. But in spite of a very warm and humid climate in this desert, Moses was getting colder and colder by the day. You see, he began his life for 40 years as the prince of Egypt. The last 40 years of his life, he was a patriarch of Israel. The middle 40 years, he was a pauper in Midian. You know, I think a lot of believers have accepted mediocrity in life as the kind of life God never intended for them to live. So I'm asking you tonight, have you become used to a cold desert? Have you accepted a spirit of discouragement and defeatism as just part of what you're going to have to live with? I think a lot of Christians have given up on the plans and promises of God. So let me ask you this, just like I did this morning, instead of turning it to questions, let me turn it to a statement. Do any of these apply to your spirituality? I've given up on dreams and goals that used to thrill my heart. At this particular time in life, I feel somewhat out of place. How about this one? I have no desire to see real change in my life. I live in fear of what others can and will do to me. Although I don't like my present location spiritually, I've just learned to accept it. I have no idea or discerning spirit of God's will in my life. I feel cold and indifferent towards God. Do any of those apply to you right now? Think about it. I believe that most of those, if not all of them, applied to Moses in the desert of Midian. He had settled for something far less than what God intended for him. Look at Exodus chapter 3, verse 5. All of that transpired in his life until this time. Here he is in the middle of a desert. He saw a lot of strange things in the desert, but he kind of got used to them. There's one thing that he couldn't get used to, and that was this bush that caught on fire but was not consumed. It kept burning. The Bible says, and he said, this is God speaking to Moses, and he said, draw not nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. You see, almost 80 years before this, Moses had been taught about the God of Abraham by his mother. But the secularism of Egypt and the somberness of the desert robbed him of his true sense of who God was. There is a cold spirit of the desert that had been in Moses' heart, and I think in a lot of people's hearts today. And it wasn't just the burning bush, it was the presence of God. The presence of God that warmed not just Moses, but I believe that part of the desert. It gave it a different kind of warmth. Look at chapter 3 again, verse 7. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of the land unto a good land and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppressed them. Come now, therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. I believe that Moses was born for that purpose.
Yes, amen.
I believe he was born to deliver God's people out of bondage. That's why God had him there. The only thing is, God wouldn't do it on Moses' terms. He did it on his own terms.
Amen.
I believe that the training and the development that Moses received in that desert, watching a whole bunch of sheep that belonged to his father-in-law, was far superior than any training he would have gotten in any Egyptian palace or school. Before Moses could lead the people of God, he first had to learn how to lead sheep in Midian. Before he could draw water from the rock, he had to learn to draw water from a well. Before he could use the rod of God as a deliverer, he'd have to use the staff of God as a shepherd. Before he could experience the glory of God in the cleft of the rock, he would have to encounter the fire of God at the burning bush. What I'm trying to say is this: sometimes God has us go through things and experience things today so that he can do something with us tomorrow.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Today is preparation for tomorrow. God had plans for Moses' life But before Moses could embrace those plans, his heart had to catch fire. Say, preacher, why are you bringing this 4 weeks, 8 sermons about being on fire for God and not being cold because of this last message? Watch. Religion, society, culture, law, history, Hebrew and human history has all changed because of Exodus chapter 3. Because of Moses. Because Moses did one thing when his heart was warmed again towards God after having a 40-year cold season, his heart was warmed and he embraced the call of God on his life. Do you realize there is no limit to what God could do with one person? If that one, I don't care how old they are or how young they are, if that one person's potential was fully surrendered to God. But if it's not fully surrendered to God, it's wasted. Young people, look for just a second. We talked about it in Sunday school a little bit today. You remember? What are you going to give to God? Remember that? Luke, you remember that? Yeah. He got candy today. What is it that you have a hard time giving to God? That was the idea. You realize that you may miss out on the greatest life you've ever had or could ever have. You say, well, you don't know how old I am. Well, Moses is 80. God used him for another 40 years. Mm-hmm. Now, I know we're not going to live 120 probably. I get that. But can I be honest? What if it's just one more day? One day changes everything. What if you had not listened to the Holy Spirit on the day you got saved? Mm. What a day that would be. Yeah. That one day changed everything. What about this? What if you had not listened to the Holy Spirit on that moment, on that day when God dealt with you about something major in your life? You can fill in the blank. A day makes a difference. So what if you have just one day left? What if you have 20 years left? Whatever it is, you have the entire rest of your life left, whatever that is. The entire rest of your life, you still have. What is it that God created you to do? You say, well, that's motivational speaking. No. I'm glad when I was 13 years old, God revealed to me the purpose of what he wanted me to do with my life. I didn't understand it, but I knew that God wanted me to be a preacher of his word. I knew it. I tried to get away from it when I was about 16, 17 years old. Not away from it, just a slight detour for a year or two. That was my plan. I'm thankful for the moment that I realized that this was the woman I was going to marry. I'm even more thankful for the day that she realized that she was the woman I was supposed to marry. It did take longer. A lot longer. I'm thankful for God's leading in my life, the unseen hand, God's grace. We sing about it tonight. What is it that God has for you? So I've served the Lord all my life. I just don't have much left. So you're planning on dying tonight. I hope not. If you have another breath, if you have another minute, you have another day to live, what is it that God wants you to do with that? Well, I just want to get a paycheck. I just want to do it. Fine, get a paycheck. But use that paycheck to fulfill God's calling in your life. What is it God has called you to do? When we say calling, here's what we think. Well, that's for preachers. That's what we think. Yeah, I personally believe that there is a divine calling in the call to preach.
Amen.
I believe that.
That's right.
Not everybody does, but I believe it. But I believe God has called every Christian, every one of his children, to full-time ministry. I mean, it's just what we do. Just what we do. What is it God's called you to do? What is he leading you to do? He was leading Moses to take the children of Israel out of Egypt and to walk around for 40 years with them until they were prepared to enter into the promised land.
That's right.
That's what he was called to do. And I want you to know that God has plans for you as well. Tonight, I want to encourage you, embrace the call of God in your life. Let it cause you to burn with passion and zeal one more time. Renew your joy in your life by living in the presence of God. And please get this. I wrote this down, and I hope this makes sense to you. It made sense to me when I typed it up. Allow God's purposed plan to become your absolute obsession. Allow God's purposed plan for your life to become your absolute obsession. Heavenly Father, tonight I ask for your help in a very special way. Lord, as your child, I want to fulfill what you have for me to do in this life. One of my goals, Lord, is to be able to say, as Jesus did, that I've accomplished everything that you've given me to do. It may not be everything I want to do. It may be different than what I want to do. But I want to accomplish everything that you've given me to do. As a husband, I want to be the right kind of husband. I want to be the right kind of father. I want to be the right kind of pastor and preacher. And the right kind of friend and son and brother. Lord, help us tonight to discern the will of God. And as we understand the will of God, and even before we understand it, may we accept it and say yes to you. And not just endure your plans, but embrace your plan for our lives. How many tonight would say your desire is to know the will of God, to do the will of God, and to delight in the will of God for your life? If that's you, would you be able to lift your hand in the air? Say, that's my desire. That's truly my heart's desire tonight. Thank you. You can lower your hands. Young people, I'm talking to you too. Teenagers and kids, I'm talking to you. More importantly, I believe the Holy Spirit's talking to you if you'll listen. It begins with a desire. And I'm glad to know that the Bible says, I think it's Philippians 2, I'm forgetting the verse, maybe 13. It is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. He's going to give you a desire to do what he wants you to do. How could I be a preacher and a pastor? Because God gave me a desire. How could Dr. Rex Richards be a preacher and a pastor for so long? Because God gave him a desire for it. How can my dad be a missionary for 20 years? God gave him a desire for it. How can you do the will of God? He's going to give you a desire for it. And then he's going to give you work in your heart to actually do it. Tonight, I'm not going to ask you to discern immediately tonight what God's will is for your life. You may know, you may not. He may have spoken to you tonight clearly. I don't know. But I don't want to put undue pressure on people to think, well, if God's will for my life, then I'm a failure. Well, maybe you just need to surrender your life to the Lord and yield it to Him, and then He'll show you. I learned with the will of God, He's not playing hide and seek. He's got it right in front of your face. And as soon as you say, Lord, whatever you have for my life, I'll do it. And it's true, and it's by faith, He reveals it to you. May not reveal next year to you. Can't we be glad that when we were 20 years old, God didn't show you the rest of your life all at once? That'd scare us to death. He reveals one step at a time. Let's take just a moment right there at your seat. Why don't you ask the Lord to reveal to you exactly what His will is for your life at this point in time, in this point of your life. Some of you are a little bit older. You're not in your 20s anymore. You're not in your 30s. You're not in your 40s. You're not even in your 50s. You're a little bit older than that. But God is not done with you. I believe that you may have more to offer than some young people do in many areas. But if you don't follow the Lord in that, you're wasting it. You're squandering the grace of God. You young people, you have more energy than anybody else in this room. You may have more potential than anybody in this room because statistically you may live longer. Have you surrendered that to the Lord? Those who are middle-aged, that'd be in my group, I guess. We're in the middle of our lives, Lord willing. God can use people in this age in a tremendous way. We're not as young as we used to be, so hopefully we're not quite as foolish as we used to be. But we got energy, and we got time, and we got a brain, and we can think, and we can move, and we can do things, and we can go, and there's so much that can be done. So much can be done. What is it God wants you to do? Lord, tonight we yield ourselves to you afresh and anew. We dedicate our lives to you, asking you to reveal to us not just a job, not just a paycheck, not just something to fill time in a day so we can say we did something. Lord, show us your divine plan for our lives. Lord, before that's even fully revealed, we say yes to you tonight. Before we even know what you may want us to do tomorrow, we say yes already. Lord, I pray that we'd be fully yielded and surrendered to you. Lord, help us not to wonder what people are going to think or say. Lord, I've learned that faith in God usually does not make sense to the world, but it's what you designed us to live by. Help us to do that. Lord, I thank you for your direction. I pray that as you guide us, that there would be an ease of mind and a plain path to walk. And Lord, we'll trust you that by your Spirit and by your word, that you will light our path as we follow you. In Jesus' name, amen. Brother Tim, we go ahead and turn it off. I want to mention a couple of things before we go.